British rally team Tuthill Porsche are about to take on one of motorsport's greatest challenges.
It's an adventure above everything else.
17 classic Porsche 911s, rebuilt from scratch.
Normally this is something you can only dream of.
Across 5,000 kilometers of the world's most demanding terrain.
Cleaning that up, four wheels, sometimes you come out with two.
Battling through breathtaking landscapes.
We spun off and we were on a cliff edge, so that's where we had to stop.
The largest rally team that motorsport has ever seen. This is the East African Safari Classic Rally.
Tension, just waiting at the flying finish of the last stage, so 38 seconds between the first two cars. We're just waiting to see who comes through and what the time gap is.
No reason to be tense. After what, 17 hours separated by seconds? It's good stuff. It makes a real fighter, it's good.
We're hoping to see a blue car, but I expect we'll see an orange one and then the stopwatch starts. And then we have 3 minutes and 38 seconds to wait.
Here he comes, here he comes.
In reality, the preparation for such an event starts a year and a half ahead of the due start date. We are, after all, taking 1970s parts, reconditioning them, strengthening them, and preparing them to be quickly and efficiently fitted during the event. So that's a huge, huge part of what we do. In total, we sent four containers full of rally cars, just rally cars, and that was using special racking systems so that we could get four cars per 40-foot container. We sent two 40-foot containers purely with 17 car kits of spare parts. We sent another couple of containers with excess stock, wheels, tyres, the bigger items that you may need. Once you hit Mombasa, which is where the stuff gets unloaded and where we base ourselves before any of the Safari Rally events, you can't rely on anything being sourced locally. You have to have everything at your disposal at any instant. First job once we arrive in Mombasa is to establish our base, and that's the base that we will be working from for the 3 weeks before the rally begins. It's hugely, hugely important to us. The countries we visit are wonderful. Kenya and Tanzania are colourful. The locals are friendly, the roads are fantastic. It's remote enough to provide that element of a challenge without being so remote that it's inaccessible. It's a great time for us all to get to know each other, which, because this event is biannual, we assemble an amazing bunch of people from all over the world. We found ourselves under this tree-topped camp for 3 weeks, and it was wonderful. Great place to do driver briefings, team briefings, prepare the cars, and then obviously the arrival of the service vehicles that are sourced locally in this instance, or some of them are sourced locally. It is a huge realization that here we go, this is for real, and it's got to happen.
Thank you.
it's really at that moment where you see cars lined up at the beginning of what's known as the toughest rally in the world that you perhaps realise what you've taken on.
Having left the start ramp in White Sands, Mombasa, Team Tuthill have begun their journey. Day one will cover 574 kilometres of loose gravel to the end of day service in Taita Hills.
First stage of the rally, it set a nice pace, I think. It's quite smooth in places. It's not the extreme rough we're going to get later on.
It's been amazing so far. I mean, it's really high-speed roads, and it's a lot of loose gravel on the top, so it's a bit slippery, but it's nice roads, and it's a nice countryside to drive through.
We've got a lot of time to do this next road section, so we can have a bit of a check.
Nice to get safety through Stig, setting the pace in the lead, Bjorn a couple of places behind, as we'd expect. I think five team cars in the top 10. The usual few incidents that you'd expect in any safari day.
We just kept pushing and pushing and pushing, and all of a sudden it was a square left and off we went. We had to use our hands and our legs to get out of there. And it took us like 15 minutes, 20 minutes, I don't know. So it was hard work. The next one is about 60Ks as well, like the last one. So we just have to keep pushing, but be smart when we push.
Meters before the end of the stage, I was 100 meters late on a call. Steve panics and hit the brakes, and we hit this jump sideways. And rolled over 1.5 times, ended up on our side. Anyway, the scrutineers inspected the car. He says the roll cage is fine, so it's all mad panic to do some bush mechanics and get it back. So we're still in. But yeah, apart from that, it was going reasonably okay.
At the end of each day, service crews set up, and we have a 2-hour controlled service time. It's the only controlled service time during the day on this event. It's a very, very important time to check the cars and ensure that they're good for the next day, because bear in mind that every bit of maintenance up until now is done under pressure on the side of the road.
Day two sees the team cover a further 595 kilometres. Crossing the border from Kenya into Tanzania and on to the end of day service in Arusha.
Side of the road service is a very unique element to this event. We do have a fair amount of interaction with the locals. If you can grease the odd bicycle chain or pump the tyres up, then it's a nice thing to do. We've got crowd control issues occasionally. Thankfully, very, very friendly and very enthusiastic, but when there's a bit of a panic on, it's nice to have some space and to be able to settle into the job at hand.
The car feels okay and stages are all right, but to be first on the road, it's a bit problem with cows and people and cars, so just have to be a bit careful. That's Africa.
Driving in any form in Kenya provides a real challenge. the service crews and the rally cars have very, very long transit sections. One has to be super alert. There's overladen trucks, there's vehicles that probably shouldn't be on the road. So you have to expect the unexpected. For the rally cars, they're light and they're nimble, and they can snuck in and out of gaps and make quite good progress. For us guys in the service vehicles, it can be a little bit more challenging. We're involved in our own mini adventure every time we're on the road and every time we're traveling between the sections.
With over 1,000 kilometers of the world's toughest classic rally complete, rally legends Stig Blomqvist and Bjorn Voldegard are leading the charge for Tuthill Porsche, with the rest of the team holding their own further down the leaderboard.
Tomorrow we're going to start with a 154 kilometre section. We've got a really good opportunity now to absolutely prep the cars, make sure that they're going to complete the full 150Ks. It's very challenging for both the drivers and the car. As you can see what's been happening, they're pretty hard at it now, going quite well, and the car's taking it.
Yeah, no, that's nothing. No, nothing. And the bolt, where the bolt goes through is not
knackered. It's a bit gnarly.
So safely into Mount Meru, Arusha, Tanzania. Bjorn and Stig second and third, on schedule, on target, the pace is right. Gerard never ever far away. A good day. It'll take us a few days to really settle in, but this is night two. Things are just falling into place very nicely.
Day three starts and finishes in Arusha, Tanzania, taking the competitors across a punishing 740 kilometers, including the rally's longest and most hazardous stage.
So every morning, cars restart the rally from Parc Fermé, which is a controlled area, and they will not have been disturbed since the night before. One thing you'll see is a scurry of activity between coordinators, co-drivers, team managers. The co-drivers have to receive this information, make the necessary changes so that when they're going along the route, they have the latest information.
Double caution, jump, must divert left and rejoin.
For us novices, just take care and look and see and learn. There is 6 days more after this. So it's going to be a really exciting day.
We're about to head out into the longest section of the rally. 150 kilometres is a huge distance for a rally car to cover, and the opportunity for disaster is very, very real. It's totally unrealistic during an event of this nature to not expect some mechanical problems. The question is how, as a team, you react when you have them. However, nothing prepared us for a catastrophic failure with a number of gears. The biggest issue was that this could affect all 17 cars, and that's something that on this scale presents a huge, huge challenge for a team to respond to.
We spotted it yesterday, and so we're taking steps to make sure that we replace all the boxes before they fail. And so far we've caught them all. 20 minutes later you've got a new gearbox. We did one yesterday. I was involved. It took 40 minutes.
Always, always crucial stage in the rally, mainly because of the distance, and the last 15 kilometres are very rough. Unfortunately, Bjorn has had a fairly sizable accident this morning, and they've rolled end over end. Thankfully, they're both okay. A real shame, because he was in a fantastic position. All to play for, but let's not forget, it's the beginning of day three. This is a long rally. In losing Bjorn, we now clearly reduced our winning ability from three drivers to two. So that leaves us with Stig and Gerard, and still in a very, very strong position.
Gerard Marcy moves up to fourth place, while survival is the key strategy for the other Tuthill entries.
We're just trying to keep out of trouble, make sure we back right off for anything that's, you know, cautioned by the organisers. We're not taking any chances, just picking our way through that, and then you know, just trying to keep it trouble free as it's been so far.
everything is taken off, everything is looked at. If there's any suspect cars or anything we haven't had time to do during the day, it is now done in this 2-hour period. Unfortunately, we lost Bjorn today with an accident on the section 6, first one. That was quite a big accident, so a bit concerning for a while. We still got two cars in the top four. The rest of the team are nicely spaced out. You know, I think all the drivers are happy with the performance, so generally we're very pleased.
Covering a staggering 996 kilometres, day four takes the team out of Tanzania, crossing the border back into Kenya, where their end-of-day service will take place in Amboseli.
We left Tanzania, crossing the border into Kenya. We've got one special stage on the way out and then a long run to the border, where we're met by a super organised bunch of officials who have a special channel to ensure that all rally cars, crews and service vehicles get between Tanzania and Kenya in the most efficient manner. It's an extraordinary part of the organisation, but one that works very, very well. There are occasions where we arrive a long time before the cars get to the service point.
We do this wherever we go, when we get bored. Right, that's the base for it.
And it's not uncommon for us to find games to keep ourselves amused.
Okay, all good to go now.
What, from the cow shit? from the road. From the cow shit. Right, this is it. First one.
Get out of the way. Whoa, one at a time, boys. We won't know who's won.
Oh, gee, you know.
No, illegal.
Of course it counts.
Yeah. Has to be a direct strike.
Pick all the stuff. Team. It's a team game.
Of course, as soon as the cars turn up, it's back to work and focusing 100% on what we're here to do.
We started off this morning with a bit of a problem. We had the brake problem, and Stig had to pump the pedal to get the brakes. And in one corner, it was one pump too much, so it was a little bit late, and the rear came out, and we got stuck on a sandbank. So then you lose 6 minutes and think, shit. And the next one, you gain it.
I think we went a minute and a half quicker than Stig, so it's maybe a little bit too quick.
Best case, we're now probably first and third. We may even be first and second. So, and that's in the space of one stage. They're now into Nairobi for one small spectator stage, one more this evening, into Amboseli for the rest day.
Really tough, but yeah, sometimes you are on high speed and the roadbooks are not completely top of the line, to be honest. So sometimes you find jumps and sometimes you find big holes in the road, so which I'm not mentioned. So it's an adventure.
Normally, a car shouldn't survive any of these stages. Then now you go stages after stages after stages. And it's not just the jumps and holes everywhere, it's very rough. The tires must be like diamonds.
So, end of day four always means a long run into Amboseli Game Park. The cars are then placed into Parc Fermé for the rest day.
For day five, the team remain in Amboseli National Park for what is known as the rest day. After 2,500 kilometres of punishing driving, the technicians have just 6 hours to service the cars thoroughly.
Yesterday we had a really tough day. Took a few casualties. A few of the guys now just putting those back together and trying to straighten a few panels. We got 6 hours to put them straight, general maintenance, checkovers, and make sure they're ready for tomorrow.
We've done all the oil and everything, got all the major stuff done. Just doing a full spanner check on the rear end. We'll check everything, absolutely everything. Nuts and bolts. We've got to do a lot of panel beating around the door still.
Getting ready for another 4 days of merciless beatings. Each day is more than our complete rally on any rally given day in the States. These things are doing 300-400K a day. It just doesn't compare. For the year of these cars and the sports car factor of them, they really hold up well.
I'm a fabricator by trade, so when the cars get damaged, I re-weld any cracks and use hydraulic presses to push them back straight enough to get them back on the road for the next day. So we just sort of do what we can with what we've got to get them back on the road.
Routine, check, check, check and check. Change the discs, change the pads.
They're giving it a really easy time. They're looking after the car. They're not taking any unnecessary risks. It's the way to do safari. You know, look after the car will look after you and you'll get to the end, hopefully. Fingers crossed.
So a momentary pause in proceedings for a cool beer. The cars are all safely back into Parc Fermé, ready to start the rally again.
So plan now is lunch. And a half an hour lunch, not like a ladies' lunch, Jim. Literally. Half an hour lunch. Then we have a little bit of rebuild work to do. We have a lot of tyres to do. In a perfect world, we will be signed off by 5 o'clock. But this world isn't perfect.
You need good things to drink, you need good things to eat, and you need some good treatments, and that's what we got.
My role is to basically look after all the drivers, co-drivers and all the team in regards to their health, welfare, nutrition, hydration. Quite a few of the boys, once they turned up to Mombasa, they ended up in work within 2 hours, so not really enough time to acclimatise, so quite a few of them had a little bit of heat stroke. With some of the boys got shoulder injuries and musculoskeletal injuries, so I've had to refer them to the physio and she's been taping them up.
It really takes it out of people's backs. The roads are so unforgiving, you know, the terrain's so hard and rough, and most of the drive's off-road, so it really does take its toll on the joints and the muscles.
The majority of the Swedish crew and the Belgians have not been here before. Difficult for them to acclimatise, so they're not used to the amount of energy that they use, and therefore they can get dehydrated quite quickly. We've sort of estimated that they need to drink about 5 litres a day whilst they're in the stages. Back at home, I work in a nice rapid response vehicle or an ambulance, and as you can see, this is our medical unit for the whole of the 3 weeks that we're here. But basically, as long as you've got the kit that we've got, there's everything that I need, really. Suture kits, if I need to suture anybody. Resuscitation kit, everything basically in there. And here we go.
With an early start for the service crews, day 6 takes the team 546 kilometres northwest of Amboseli National Park, finishing with end of day service in Naivasha.
So there's no question in my mind that the real heroes of the team are their technicians. There's 51 on this event. It's a tough job, but it's also very, very rewarding.
It's 20 past 5 in the morning. We're heading out on day 6 of the rally. I think we're about 60% through the rally driving-wise for the crews. So hopefully they can just keep, preserve their position now and just keep it steady away, get to the end and without any more mishaps or dramas. I think our Land Cruiser has been getting a harder time than the Porsche, but...
How are you driving?
The East African Safari Classic Rally operates a roadside service system. As a result of this, the service technicians cover vast distances to ensure they meet their car at the end of each rally stage.
Just waiting for the cars to come out of the stage, and then we'll give it a quick spanner check over, put some fuel in it, and then crack on with the rest of the day.
You do fuel and then clean the screen, and then I'll come back to you with any other jobs as soon as I can.
Checking that nothing's come loose.
What would happen is you go along and it would step out of line when you booted it. Yeah.
Okay. Coming down, Brycey. Yeah. Yeah, grab me a cable tie, please, mate.
We couldn't see any evidence of anything out of the ordinary. So you've got to put it down to the wet conditions.
Next service, which is, as you can see, we're in a bit of a rush to get there. Quite a long road section and a short stage, so we need to get there before our car does.
The leaderboard is looking healthy for Tuthill Porsche. Although local rival Ian Duncan holds the lead, Stig Blomqvist is in a close second, with Gerard Marcy in third, and the rest of the team cars making steady progress.
I just finished the second stage. Four cars come through safely. Now going to a bit of a hold and a regroup before going into the final stage of the day and heading up towards Naivasha. Second and third, and David is running in eighth position.
The guys seem to be keeping this car going really well. They're thoroughly enjoying it because they're on top of everything as we stop. Great fun.
Oh boy, that shaft's come loose.
There you go. Small service now, I think it's a 5 minute service. Just be a quick look over and send him on to the finish then, and we can spend 2 hours fixing it.
It's obviously had a bit of a shunt up the back by one of the other competitors in an Escort, so we'll have to pull that out later on tonight. So we're just going to follow the cars back to the hotel where we're staying tonight and where we service this evening.
A reasonably good day today. We've got cars in second, third and fifth places overall. Stig in second place, chasing Ian Duncan. There's still only a couple of minutes between them, so there's still all to play for at the front.
I would expect us to be finished by 7:30, 8 o'clock, at the latest, really. And then hopefully get a bit of R&R and a couple of beers and get ready for tomorrow.
As the distances begin to take their toll on energy levels, day 7 will see the crews cover another 709 kilometres, a round trip that starts and finishes in Naivasha.
Day 7, 3 days to run. It's a crucial time in the team where you find that people start to become a little bit fatigued. One of the things we've done this year for the first time is had proper on-event catering.
So we're 7 of 9, going good, energy levels are high, riding the sugar wave, high on cinnamon sugar buns, you know, the usual good stuff, rally food.
We're catering for up to 129 people, which is quite a large number to be out in the middle of the bush. It's an interesting thing to try and cater for. It's what we do, trying to give a different variation on what people actually want, what they can eat and drink. To cook noodles for 120, it's a lot of noodles. It's difficult because you've got to try and time it, and you want to make sure that the drivers, when they come in, they've only got 10, 15 minutes maybe. You want to make sure that there is food there and they're not sitting around waiting.
Thank you.
Approaching the 4,000 kilometre mark, the relentless stages continue and the battle at the top of the leaderboard intensifies.
It has been very roughy and very tricky and actually quite difficult to find our way sometimes, but finally we managed to do it.
I like this stage, and this one is fast, it's dangerous, it's rocks, it's sand. So.
It's Jeremy's birthday and we haven't got any candles in the service kit, which seems to be a bit of a problem. So I'm trying to make this piece of wood burn and then we can offer him many happy returns. But he has it every 2 years. He has a birthday every year, but every 2 years, obviously, we're in Kenya. But I think we've had 4 birthdays on the team during this rally, so.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jeremy. Happy birthday to you!
Thank you. Thanks everybody for coming to my party.
Happy birthday to you! Happy birthday to you!
Jeremy!
Happy birthday to you!
Mind 11:45, don't come too quickly.
Next year, definitely have to bring some candles.
Today's gone really well. Stig's retaking the lead. Ian Duncan's had a puncture and Stig was quite fast in the last stage. Then we've got Gerard Marcy, who's consolidated his third place. As far as I know, he's had no real problems. One of the guys I'm particularly looking after is David and Alec Horsey, and they've done a great job and they're still in fifth place, again with very few car problems. And I think the team's doing a great job. And at the end of the day, these are historic cars, so it's a real test for the car.
Late night Vasher, end of day 7, 2 days to run, and certainly a sense of pressure building. We can see the finish, but we're by no means there. Motorsport creates legends, and the Safari Rally is no exception. In our team, we're joined by two former world champions, Bjørn Valdegard and Stig Blomqvist. They have more hours driving cars in Kenya than the combined total of the rest of the drivers put together.
When I came to Kenya the very first time, 1971, I somehow fell in love with the country and with the people and with the rally.
Yeah, I haven't really had any luck down here. That's the thing, you never know what's behind the next corner, really.
When I won it the first time, 1977, it was the year of 25 years of independence for Kenya. It was 25 years of Queen Elizabeth as a queen in England. We prepared well, and at the end of the day, we won. So everybody was extremely happy. Maybe also the queen, but who knows?
The African people is really nice and friendly. Cheering and waving and things.
And every time I come back to Africa and I pass a village, I have almost one memory everywhere. When we were here together 2007 in a Ford, both of us, I won and Stig was happy for my win because he had some problem. And we are good friends and appreciate each other.
Nothing more than the speed on the roads, the rest is friendly and we do what we can for each other. But okay, when we are in the car driving, then of course you want to beat each other.
You are fighting, you will not let the other one win. But I will let Stig win this year.
Try to come back sometime and win this rally, because I've never done that before.
As this incredible journey races towards the end, day 8 sees the team drive over 500 kilometres towards tighter hills. Stig Blomqvist and Gerard Marcy remain in the hunt for victory.
So day 8 is an exceptionally long day for us all, down to tighter. The cars are darting in and out of the Rift Valley, and part of that means they pass through many, many small villages.
No, we're just watching the cars on the tracker, and it shows that Stig's just at the end of the stage now, or the control, so he'll be here in about 30 seconds. Here he is.
I've got a puncture on the rim.
How was your puncture train?
It wasn't good. I think it was
it?
You've been practicing all night.
I've done a couple of puncture changes before, so it was working. Yeah.
Well, a lot of traffic in there. Both directions, we met, I don't know, 10 trucks, and one idiot was even overtaking there, so we have to stop and wait for him to get past.
Just finished the first stage of the day. Our lead this morning was 1 minute, and after the first 50 Ks and the end of stage one this morning, we now have a lead of 4 minutes, which is a huge success. Last night we fitted some stronger wheels, and we've really been pushing Stig and Stefan to have a go.
What do you want to do for tomorrow? Because this is where you have to think.
Because this next stage is definitely one for us to take time.
Yeah, we have to go
all corners, all corners.
Yeah, we have
but it
to
means
go
then you run first tomorrow.
Yeah, right.
I think
we have to do that.
Turns out Ian got another puncture. And the fact is now the puncture thing is in his head. He can't push hard. So if we keep clean and we have no problems, things are looking up.
At the close of 8 days of punishing rallying, local rival Ian Duncan leads former WRC champion Stig Blomqvist by 9 seconds. With the rest of the Tuthill Porsche team closing up the leaderboard, Stig is in a strong position to go for the win.
This is the easy job driving the car. The mechanics have the hardest job, I would say, definitely. Yeah.
Absolutely knackered. I'm too old for this, to be honest. Spent all day flat out in the truck just to keep up because it's such long mileages, but it's rallying, I suppose.
It starts way before the event, that's the problem. Preparation, getting everything sorted, loading your service van, getting everything prepared, because this event, once you leave your base, you've got have everything with you to make this event work. You can't, you know, just go into a shop and buy something.
Final big service of the rally. There is a sense of calm that descended across the service area as everybody concentrates with one thing in mind, and that's to make the cars the best they can be for the final day. For sure, everyone's tired, but adrenaline's kicked in and we're nearly there.
After over 4,500 kilometres of the world's most treacherous roads, the competitors square up for another 350 kilometres of stages before crossing the finish ramp back in Mombasa.
So this is it, one final day of rallying. After 18 months of preparation, it's between Stig and Ian, and for sure, Ian's not going to make it easy.
Pretty incredible. It's never ever seen this sort of action on a safari rally. It's all so very close, it's seconds. Normally we're fighting minutes.
After almost 1,600K, it's 9 seconds splitting us. So the last one, we had a go on it, and I think Ian said he missed a junction or something like that. Maybe braking a little bit too late. We saw some tracks there.
That's a very interesting fight to follow, but it's unbelievable after 16 hours of driving to get such a less gap. This stage we did now, it's just fantastic. It's a wonderful stage. This could be WRC stage. It's mega, nothing rough, just high speed corners and stuff, jumps and everything. That's the best stage of the rally.
Going into the final stage, we were confident we'd done all we could do. We have a small lead, but we all know that even on the last stage, anything can happen.
So it's a long stage, rough stage as well in some sections. So, I mean, 30 seconds is nothing. We have 38 now on him, so it's almost nothing. One puncture away.
Just waiting at the flying finish of the last stage, so 38 seconds between the first two cars. We're just waiting to see who comes through and what the time gap is.
No reason to be tense. It must be the closest safari finish on record almost. After what, 17 hours separated by seconds? It's good stuff.
We're hoping to see a blue car, but I expect we'll see an orange one and then the stopwatch starts. And then we have 3 minutes and 38 seconds to wait.
What is going through your mind is that you know as soon as you see Ian cross the finish line, the countdown starts. Stig had to appear within a given time frame, and if he did, we won the rally. However, news broke shortly after Ian arrived that Stig was in trouble and that he had actually got a puncture. Our hearts sunk. It's quite a cruel way to hear that you may not win the rally, because up until that point you're focused on a stopwatch. It's just a load of numbers flashing by, and you know there's a certain point at which, if he arrives, life's great, and if he doesn't, life's full of disappointment.
Carry on! Is he still running?
Yeah, just changing a tire.
Hurts a bit. Really hurts. But there we are. The guys have obviously had a rear puncture here, so they've left the socket on here and the one wheel nut off, so it could be even faster to change the wheel. They tried. It's the toughest rally in the world. This is why.
So to stand there in Mombasa and see all the team cars come over the finish ramp is a wonderful, wonderful feeling. To take part in this rally is amazing. To finish it is an extraordinary accomplishment for anyone. Despite the fact that the win hadn't been secured, it's a wonderful, wonderful thing to be involved in.
Here we are, the morning after the day before, and I'm still a bit, I guess I'm hurting a little bit still. I didn't realise how much we wanted to win, and we were very close. I'm sure we'll get over it, but the reality is, when you come that close to a victory, you want it even more. We have to look at the picture as a whole. We only lost two cars, essentially. Bjorn had a huge accident, which we're very glad he survived, relatively unscathed. And another client hurt his back. So from the 17 starters, we had 15 cross the line, all in good shape. There's a bit of panel damage, but we should be very, very proud. And I'm sure, give it a couple of weeks, we will be. Well, life continues. Safari still is a huge focus for us. And despite the fact it's 2 years away, I'm sure the preparations will start fairly imminently. Travelled 5,000 kilometres. I say on average we'll have had 6 hours sleep per night in the last 3 weeks. I think I've walked on average 20 kilometres a day. Heart rate will have been fairly high for most of it. Blood pressure certainly through the roof at times. But we've had a great time. We've seen
this beautiful country again. We've been to Tanzania, we've been all through Kenya. We've shared amazing times and memories, and that's what the Safari Rally does. It's a once in a lifetime that we are so lucky to do every 2 years. And every 2 years it's different and it presents new challenges. That's why we love it and that's why we'll come back.